you, Renata. So we will present a part of the project. As you have understood, it's an international comparison, and our role in the project as members of the coordinating team with Renata was to go deeper in the understanding of the institutional context, the 9 countries covered by our European study. So the idea was to understand that, of course, there is a huge diversity of institutional context in Europe, even if the Commission has general goals concerning the social protection of independent workers and self-employed workers. We must recognize that in reality we have a huge diversity of institutional context. So we'll go deeper in the understanding of this diversity. However, we must also recognize that IPROs, as defined by Rapelli, we often use and we often refer to this definition of Rapelli, it's only a statistical category. So we can consider a series of workers belonging to nascent roles, but it's not a regulatory or an institutional category. So that's the reason why in our international comparison, we made a focus on self-employed. Classical, I would say, self-employed, but by focusing on solo self-employed, so it means without employees. And when a third status, or something like a third status, we had huge debate in our research about what is a third status or not. So we finally adopted the idea of a hybrid status, something in the middle between employees and self-employed. When a third or a hybrid status was existing, we focused on this category of people. So when it doesn't exist, we just consider solo self-employed. When it does exist, we focus on hybrid categories of workers. And then we try to build something, but we must recognize that this is rather difficult when you make international comparison. We were obliged to use rough indicators in order to make a comparison. So I'm sure that some of you will say, okay, but in Italy it's just not exactly like that. And in France we have some subspecific category and so on. Of course, but the idea was to find general tendencies and try to show or to see if we have the possibility to understand the influence of the national context on the social protection of independent workers. And we focused our attention to what we call structural factors. So depending on the regulatory framework, for example, but also on what we call agency factors. For example, when we consider the strategies of unions regarding self-employed, are they open or not open to self-employed people? That's not a structural factor, that's more an agency factor that we try to take into account. So, in a nutshell, we have 9 countries, the 9 countries covered by the study, and we have a series of factors that we try to take into account. So, first of all, is there or not a specific recognition of something in the middle, in the gray zone between employment and self-employed? Is there just a binary approach, what we call the binary approach, distinguishing employee and self-employed people? Second category of variable, about the social dialogue. What could we say about the union density, the union coverage rate? It's not really, that's not exactly the same, as you said, as you know, because we can have a very low density of, in terms of unionization, but we can have a large coverage of collective bargaining, covering all workers, even if they are not members of unions, for example. So we have to distinguish these two variables. And also, we want to also to consider the union strategies vis-à-vis self-employed. Are they open or not to membership of self-employed people? We also considered the fiscal support offered to self-employed in the nine countries. And finally, as a dependent variable to a certain extent, we try to characterize the scope of social protection. And it's particularly on this variable that we use very low indicator and try to classify the different countries in very big and very rough categories. So Laura will explain in more details the different variables that we surveyed in the study. And then I will come back to with the conclusion of our comparative analysis.
Thank you, François. So now let's enter in our first nine mentioned regulatory frameworks. So here we have clustered all the countries in three categories. You will see here. So the first country is Sweden, that you see has a characteristic that does not provide any legal distinction between the work statuses. The second cluster is made of Belgium, Netherlands, and France that legally opposes employees and self-employed statuses. That's the approach that François told you before, the binary approach. You are either self-employed or employees. And finally, the five last countries, Spain, Slovenia, Germany, Italy, and UK, considers an intermediate working situation that is located in between employee and self-employed statuses. So we called those approach the binary approach, the first, which you are either employees or self-employed, and the other, we call it the hybrid approach. So here the things are exposed more in detail, so you see here the different working situations that are located in between in Spain, Slovenia, Germany, Italy, and UK, and you see that the economically dependent self-employed are considered here in the middle. You see in Germany the employer-like person, in Italy the semi-subordinated contracts, and finally in UK we consider the workers. So here are the different statuses. So let's enter now in the second main category, which is union density, coverage range of collective bargaining and union strategy vis-à-vis self-employed worker, because it is an important variable in the way in which the industrial relation system is organized in each country. So first, you see here that the employees' unionization rate considerably varies across the countries. So I don't know if it is, if everybody can read it and see it. But what we can see here is that there is differences regarding the employees' unionization between the countries. But the next slide is about a table in which we cluster the country. You can see that Sweden and Belgium are considered as having a high unionization rate, that is up to 50%. Slovenia, Italy, and UK have a medium one, that is situated between 20 and 50%. And Spain, France, Germany, and Netherlands have a low unionization rate, below 20%. Next, you have here the representation of the coverage of collective bargaining in each country. So we consider it the coverage of collective bargaining as, giving you a definition, the number of employees that are covered by a collective agreement divided by the total number of wage and salary earners. So we have here different request of the contribution in the table, and we consider it, as you can see, Sweden and Belgium as having a high collective bargaining coverage, more than 75%. Like Spain, Italy, France, and Netherlands. And Slovenia, Germany have a medium collective bargaining coverage, situated between 50 and 75%. And finally, UK have a low collective bargaining coverage, under 50%. So we have also considered the union strategies with the self-employed workers. So here, we asked ourselves the question, what degree of inclusion of those employers, workers in a traditional union? So we see that all countries have an inclusive attitude vis-à-vis self-employed worker, Belgium and France making exception, even if there are some incidents that we do not consider that it's enough to be considered as inclusive. So we also, in the third dimension, consider the fiscal support to self-employment. So to avoid a detailed presentation in each country, we surveyed the main categories of support offered by crossing data from the national reports and from the ESPN report, so the European Social Policy Data, and we identify three types of fiscal support that we consider it. The first one is the financial incentives to the development of business activities. The second one is the tax or social contribution exemption. And the third is access to loans at preferential rates. So here, I can say that this data that I will show you must be carefully understood because it covered very different fields, very different things. But it was great for us to have some kind of a view of what is going on the fiscal, as far as the fiscal support is considered. So we consider that if we have the three variables, we score it three. If two variables were observed, we score it two, etc. So you can see here that France has three types of supports, Belgium have two, Netherlands, Germany, Italy have three at the three. UK have one type of support, Slovenia is considered as medium, so two types. And finally, Sweden is as considered as having a high level of fiscal support, considering the fact that it is the crossing data between the highway or national report and the ESPN, as I told you before. So let's enter now in the scope of social protection. In the nine countries, the accessibility, the level of social protection may vary significantly, as a lot of variables like the eligibility condition, the benefits, the duration of benefits, the qualifying period, etc., etc. So, as François told you, we have developed some rough indicators, knowing that there are some exceptions. But here we have considered three degrees of social protection. The first is that we have considered the social protection as full when the self-employed are compulsorily insured under all schemes. We have considered as medium when the self-employed are insured under all schemes, but sometimes by voluntarily opt-in. And finally, we have considered as limited when the self-employed are excluded from one or more schemes and cannot opt-in. So there are the three degrees of social protection we have observed. considering the fact that things are much more complicated, but it was a way to compare the different countries regarding the social protection. So here, in the binary approach, which I called it's a binary, so you are either employee or self-employed, Belgium, France, and the Netherlands have a limited degree of social protection, considering the fact that, the self-employed are excluded from one or more social security schemes, often from unemployment insurance or protection against accident at work, occasional disease. And Sweden, which we consider as binary, have a full degree of social protection because it is some kind of a universal system regarding the social protection that is offered to self-employed. Considering the social protection of self-employed workers in the hybrid approach, we can see here then that Italy, Germany, UK have a limited degree of social protection for different reasons. In Italy, because the social protection is submitted to several restrictions. In Germany, social protection of the employee-like worker, so the status in between, I told you before, is presumed a little bit higher, but often ignored and not used by the self-employed. The workers in UK has less rights than regular employees. In Slovenia, you can see that the degree of social protection is considered as full because self-employed have full access to social security. And finally, in Spain, the trade can voluntarily opt in some schemes. The point is that the degree of social protection were in between full and limited because they can opt in system for some insurance-based schemes. So, with all those variables I told you, we try to think about all, as François told you before, to think about all these variables all together in order to think, to see if the interrelation between those variables can explain the good or not social protection offered to the self-employed. So, the creation of a third status, is it finally a relevant institutional answer? That's the question we ask in this report. So, because it is often considered like this, but here we can see that in UK, in Italy, and Germany, the social protection offered to self-employed workers, and there is over there in the hybrid status, remains limited. In Spain and Germany, hybrid statuses are not very successful. They are not very used by people. So those different elements, sorry, there is a new operation. Slovenia, full access to social security. Spain, as I told you, voluntary opt-in system. So it is not considered as a universal system. And the last things tell you is that the institutional recognition of hybrid work arrangement may be attractive for user only. That's things that we see also in the national reports and other data. And so it leads us to the conclusion that the creation of a third status, for a hybrid status, is not a relevant institutional answer per se. So it must be think with other variables that I will tell you before. So the fiscal support. In Belgium, fiscal support, platform work that we mentioned in the report, so fiscal measure in order to help the self-employed, etc., does not provide any legal protection in terms of minimum wage, liability of user in case of accident at work, social rights, etc. So in France, we can see that a significant amount of self-employed workers in the micro-entrepreneur regime is affected by poverty. So it seems that the fiscal support may contribute to the growth of business activities and directly to the generation of incomes, but it does not offer any social protection. The inclusiveness of union strategies is the third variables we consider. We can see that 7 out of 9 countries have inclusive strategies, but it does not guarantee a high level of social protection for the self-employed worker. In Italy, UK, Netherlands and Germany, the social rights of the self-employed worker remains limited, like in France and Belgium, where exclusive union strategies are observed. So inclusive union strategies cannot help us to predict the level of social protection offered to self-employed workers. So for the collective bargaining coverage in UK, there is a low coverage rate of collective bargaining with a low social protection. So in Spain, there is a high coverage rate of collective bargaining with a medium social protection. In Belgium and France, there is a very high coverage rate of collective bargaining, but with limited social protection. So here, it seems that the collective bargaining coverage cannot guarantee, as such, a sustainable social protection for the social worker. So I will give you
so it means that we can be a little bit frustrated after this exercise, because we want to show, you know, linkages between the structural variables and the level of social protection, and we were not able to see a significant tendency. For example, the case of the inclusiveness of union strategies is a little bit disappointing, because we could imagine that the more the unions are open to self-employed, the more it will lead to social protection for them. But we were not able to establish this correlation. So, in conclusion, it means that